Good evening, my dear brothers and sisters, and welcome to another session with the scriptures. As we come close to Christmas, we are looking at the birth of Jesus. And the Bible gives us the stories of the birth of Jesus, which we refer to as the infancy narratives. The infancy narratives, strictly speaking, are stories of the birth and the infancy of Jesus. And they're narrated to us, and hence the term infancy narratives. Now, these infancy narratives serve two purposes. The first is they serve as an introduction to the gospel. They tell us who this person Jesus is. They are not merely interested in giving us a birth story. Everyone knows Jesus was born. And so telling us about how he was born and going into the details doesn't make sense unless they're giving us something even deeper. In other words, a theological reflection on the birth of Jesus. And so in and through the infancy narratives, we find all the themes that we are going to find in the Gospels themselves. And so the infancy narratives are rightly called the Gospel in a nutshell, because in this, you find every theme that you're going to find in the Gospels. The infancy narratives are found in two of the four canonical Gospels. They're found in the Gospel according to St. Matthew and the Gospel according to St. Luke. Today, we're going to focus on the Gospel according to St. Matthew, and the following week, we will reflect on the Gospel according to St. Luke. Let us look at how Matthew presents Jesus to us. The first thing to keep in mind is Matthew's audience. Matthew is writing to an audience that is largely Jewish. And so he's going to use a lot of Old Testament citations, Old Testament quotations, because the Jews knew their scripture well. And Matthew wants to show that Jesus is the fulfillment of the Old Testament. Let's read how Matthew begins his gospel account. The beginning of the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. A short verse, and yet this verse is loaded with meaning. It is the beginning of the genealogy. Where else have we heard this word or this phrase, the beginning? Yes, in the book of Genesis. And so he's giving us the beginning or the genesis of who Jesus is. Now, very often you and I would think of Jesus as someone who was born 2,000 years ago. As someone who was born in Bethlehem and who lived and is popularly known as Jesus of Nazareth. But notice what Matthew tells us. Matthew tells us that Jesus is born as the son of David and the son of Abraham. Why are these titles important? Well, because who is David? David is the king. And why is David important? Because from David, we would receive the Messiah. And who is the renowned son of David? Solomon. And so Matthew wants to show Jesus to us, the readers or the listeners, as the new Solomon. Why the new Solomon? Well, because what was Solomon known for? Two things: for his wisdom and for building the temple. Thirdly, Solomon was the royal son of David. And so Matthew, in this one small phrase, calling Jesus the son of David, is teaching us that Jesus is the royal Messiah. He is wisdom incarnate, and he is the one who will rebuild the temple. Not a temple built by hands, but he himself will be the temple. And that's what we find in the Gospels. The second title is that of son of Abraham. And why is this important? Because the promise made to Abraham was that through your descendant, all the nations of the earth will receive a blessing. And so Jesus is that Abrahamic descendant through whom the entire world will be blessed. As we continue to focus on the genealogy of Jesus, we have a number of names. And what stands out in Matthew's account of the genealogy is that while most Jewish genealogies would trace the ancestry from the paternal side or the father's side, Matthew does this, but he includes the names of five women. He includes the names of five women. Now, this was unheard of in the genealogies at the time of Jesus. So why would Matthew include the name of these five women? Matthew selects these women. It's not just any woman that he quotes, but every time this woman is present, these women are present, Matthew is pointing to a change in the direction of Israelite history. In other words, Matthew is telling us that God can write straight even on crooked lines. Each of these women had something irregular in their marriage, and therefore they were scandals. And yet God uses these scandals in order to bring about his purpose, in order to bring about his plan of salvation. And that's Matthew's point of showing us that in spite of all these things, God still is with his people. God's promise comes to fruition. The next thing we can notice of Matthew's genealogy is there are three sections. And each of these sections are of 14 names, 14 generations. Now, this obviously is an artificial creation. But then why does Matthew stick to such an artificial creation? To show us that God had meticulously planned when the Messiah would come. In the fullness of time, Jesus was born. And this, my dear brothers and sisters, is what Matthew wants to drive home. Now, obviously, there are many more things that we can draw out from the genealogy. But in this short session, we won't have time to delve into the many beautiful nuggets that Matthew gives us. The second aspect that we find after the genealogy is the story of Joseph who accepts Jesus. Now, at the end of the third section, we have Joseph who is a dreamer and who is described as a righteous man, somebody who follows the law, who keeps God's commands. And he knows that Mary, his wife, is pregnant, but he has not yet come to live with Mary. And so the obvious conclusion in Joseph's mind is that Mary has had an affair with someone. And Joseph is based on the Joseph of the Old Testament. What is the Old Testament Joseph known for? He was known to be a dreamer. He dreamt. But each of his dreams pointed out to the salvation of Israel. And this new Joseph in the New Testament is also somebody who dreams. And as he believes in his dreams and acts on them, he brings about salvation for the new Israel. And so, my dear brothers and sisters, as we reflect upon this, what happens in Joseph's dream? The angel comes to him and tells him that what is in Mary is not of any man, but is of the Holy Spirit. And so do not be afraid to take her as your wife. Now, Joseph is a very important personality in the genealogy. Why? Because he is of Davidic descent. And by the fact that he accepts Jesus as his own, he is able to lend Jesus the Davidic descent through legal means rather than biological means. And so, just as in today's day and age, if you were to adopt a child, that child would have your name, that child would share in your legality. In the same way, Jesus shares in the Davidic lineage in and through Joseph who adopts him and who names him. What else do we see after this? we see that when Jesus is born, we have the Magi or the wise men who come to see Jesus. Now, here we have a beautiful and interesting story that is given to us. The Magi or the wise men are people from the East. And these are people probably from Persia who are called the Magi. These are stargazers. They are astronomers, not astrologers, but astronomers, people who study the stars. And at the time of Jesus, it was believed that whenever a great personality was born, there was a new star that was born. And so when they looked at the sky and they saw a new star, they recognized that there was a new personality, a new king who was born. And so what is Matthew doing? He is showing that even those who are non-Jews, Persians or people from the East, are able to recognize that this great personality, Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God, is born. Although they did not have recourse to the scriptures, yet they know that the King of the Jews is born. And so they follow the star and travel. And where do they reach? They reach Israel and they come to Jerusalem and they come to King Herod. And they ask, where is the King of the Jews who is born? Where is the newborn King of the Jews? And we are told that Herod is perturbed. Well, obviously, if there is a new King of the Jews and it's not from his family, Herod would be perturbed because he is going to be dethroned. But more importantly, the history of Herod goes way back to the beginning of Judaism. We know that Abraham had a son, Isaac, and that Isaac had two sons, Esau and Jacob. And Israel comes from the 12 sons of Jacob, the 12 tribes of Israel. But there was also another son of Isaac, Esau, who was actually the firstborn and who sold off his birthright. Herod is a descendant of Esau. He's called an Edomite. And so we have Herod, who is, and this entire descendants of Esau, who constantly are like the underdogs, hoping to regain the blessings of Abraham and of Isaac, to regain the promises that God made. And so finally, when Herod comes on the scene, the Edomians or the Edomites, they are able to really gain power and the upper hand over the Israelites. And the whole of Israel obviously hated Herod, but he had the backing of the Romans. And so Herod was perturbed. And the whole of Jerusalem, because Herod was known to be a cruel and a madman. And there was no telling what he would do. And so everyone was on their guard. What is this chap going to do now? And so as the wise men come to Herod, what do they do? Herod consults the chief priests and they go to the scriptures and they say he is to be born in Bethlehem. Now Bethlehem, the word Bethlehem simply means a house of bread, a house where everyone will be fed. And so you can see already the theological meaning here for Jesus to be born in Bethlehem, because Jesus will call himself later the bread of life. And so obviously somebody who is born in Bethlehem, the house of bread, is now to be the bread of life for the whole world. And so we see as the wise men follow the directions that is given to them by Herod and the others, they come and they visit the child Jesus. And as they visit the child Jesus, they bring out gifts. And Matthew is very, very specific in mentioning what kind of gifts. Three gifts: gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Now, why these three particular gifts? Why not gold, diamonds, and silver? Why gold, frankincense, and myrrh? Well, Matthew, among other things, wants to highlight that these are no ordinary gifts, but these are Solomonic gifts. What do I mean by this? If you were to open your Bibles and read from 1 Kings chapter 10, which is the story of the Queen of Sheba, immediately after that, we have the Bible that tells us that Solomon had great amounts of gold unlike anyone. He had these great ships of Tarshish that went and brought in a lot of gold and a lot of things. And it goes on to tell us that silver was regarded as nothing in Solomon's time. Everything was made of gold. Secondly, Solomon was known to use the finest frankincense. And myrrh was an oil, an ointment that was used. And this was used for perfuming. And it was also used for anointing bodies. And the finest of frankincense and myrrh were known to be there with Solomon. Solomon used the best. And so when Matthew is hinting at gold, frankincense and myrrh, he's pointing out to Jesus, who is the new Solomon, but not just the new Solomon, but he is someone greater than Solomon. Why do I say this? When did Solomon have all these things? He had all these things when he was the king and at the zenith of his reign. So he worked hard towards this and he earned these things. But look at Jesus. He's a newborn baby. He's just there laid in a manger. And these gifts are being brought to him. And so, as Jesus would tell us in the gospel, there is someone greater than Solomon here. And Matthew is highlighting this point. Just as Solomon, who had all these things and who built the temple, the little child who is greater than Solomon will have all these things as an infant and he will replace the temple. He himself will be the temple where God resides. And so we can see, my dear brothers and sisters, as we look at the infancy narratives, the beauty that is being given to us. As we know the story of the wise men, once they learn in a dream that Herod wants to kill the child, they escape and return to their country by another route. And Herod is now furious. But remember what we said earlier, that Jesus is also being portrayed to, is primarily being portrayed to a Jewish audience. And so one of the great symbols of Judaism is Moses. And Moses is the one who led his people into the promised land. He led them to the threshold of the promised land. He's the one who brought them out of slavery. And here we have Jesus as the new Moses. How do we know this? Well, because just like Moses, when he was born, the Pharaoh, the evil king, ordered that all male newborns should be thrown into the river Nile. They should be killed. And Moses was the one child that was saved. Similarly, my dear brothers and sisters, we have Jesus, the one child who is saved while the many are slaughtered. The many innocent are slaughtered at Herod's orders. The next dream that Joseph sees is that Herod is dead and he should return back because those who wanted to kill the child are now themselves dead. Then he goes and settles down in Nazareth. And Matthew, my dear brothers and sisters, tells us this was to fulfill a prophecy that he shall be called a Nazarene. Now, there is only one problem here. Throughout the Old Testament, you will never find this quotation anywhere. He shall be called a Nazarene. So why is Matthew giving us this quotation? Well, perhaps because the root word here, Nazar, means a branch, and a branch that is grafted. And so probably what Matthew wants to tell us is that Jesus is grafted into his people Israel. As you look at the entire story given to us in the infancy narrative that Matthew gives us, Jesus is the new Moses, he is the new Solomon and someone greater than Solomon, he is the new Isaac, the promise through whom every nation of the world will be blessed. As you continue to read the infancy narratives, go through them slowly. Take the time to read them. See what the Word of God is telling you. And you will be greatly enriched knowing the beauties that the Word of God has for you and for me. God bless you. We'll see you again next week with the infancy narratives according to St. Luke. God bless you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear friends, we wish to appreciate Father Michael for his inspirational insights into the birth of Jesus from the infancy narrative according to the Gospel of Matthew. We shall now use the Lectio Divina among the oldest methods of prayer using the Word of God in our Catholic tradition to reflect on the importance of our family. Lectio Divina consists of four steps. Step 1, Lectio, to read the Word of God. Step 2, Meditatio, to meditate on the Word of God. Step 3, Oratio, to pray with the Word of God. Step 4, Contemplatio, to rest in the Word of God. We shall commence by invoking the Holy Spirit for His assistance through this hymn. Let us now pray the opening prayer together. Almighty Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son came among us as one of us, a human being among other people, simple, accessible, yet your human face and the measure of that a human person is. Lord, make us discover ourselves in His mirror, that we are born to be free, to be unselfish, available, committed, free from our selfishness, our cowardice, and attitudes of conformism, that we may become what you want us to be. Like your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The first step, Lectio, to read the Word of God. I invite you to read aloud the text from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 1, verses 1 to 17, which will now appear on your screen. The question I ask myself in Lectio is, what does the biblical text say in itself? The gospel text that we read tells us about the genealogy of Jesus. The genealogy traces the identity of Jesus. He is the son of David and the son of Abraham. Son of David is the response of the expectation of the Jews. Son of Abraham is a source of blessings for all the nations. Both Jews and pagans see their hope realized in Jesus. We recognize the inclusion of the Gentiles in the plan of God from the beginning. The purpose of the genealogy is not to give an accurate history, but to set the story of Jesus into the context of the ongoing story of God's acts in history that will culminate in the coming of God's kingdom and on one who is himself God with us. The genealogy is not merely a list of individuals, but the story of God's plan in a community. In the patriarchal society of Jews, the genealogies indicated only names of men. It is surprising that Matthew indicates also names of five women among the ancestors of Jesus: Tamar, Rahab, Ruth, the wife of Uriah, Bathsheba, and Mary. The four women mentioned along with Mary have an abnormality in their marital relationship. Additionally, the four of them are foreigners. They conceived their sons outside the normal canons and do not correspond to the requirements of the laws of purity. However, their initiatives, which were not really conventional, gave continuity to the lineage of Jesus and led all the people to the salvation of God. Matthew is interested in showing that God's plan worked even through irregular and somewhat scandalous ways. The second step, meditatio, to meditate on the word of God. The question I ask myself in meditatio is, what does the biblical text say to me? Am I aware of my personal identity as a child of God? Have I ever tried to prepare my own family tree? Do I take pride in my ancestral lineage and family traditions? Do I maintain good relations with the members of my extended family? Do I believe that Jesus has come for the salvation of the entire human race? Am I able to easily accept and forgive people in my own family who may have hurt me? Do I recognize the indispensable role women play in the welfare of the family and society? The third step, oratio, to pray with the word of God. The question I ask myself is, what do I say to the Lord in response to His word? During these few moments of silence, speak to the Lord and respond to His words, especially thanking Him for the gift of your family. Let us now together pray the prayer for the family on your screen. Defend, we beseech you, O Lord, by the intercession of the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, this your family from all adversity, and being prostrate before you with all our hearts, mercifully protect us from the snares of the enemy. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The fourth step, contemplatio, to rest in the word of God. The question I ask myself in contemplatio is, what conversion of mind, heart, and life is the Lord asking of me? Now, remain in restful silence before God, who has used His divine word to hold you in His transforming embrace. Let us now conclude the Lectio Divina with a hymn.
All I ask of you is forever to remember me. as we make our